on this edition of Exposé. Thinking as a terrorist might think. Probing America's vulnerabilities.
I feel sometimes that I understand these guys better than I understand myself.
An explosive story.
Stop!
And a reporter on a mission.
Funding for Exposé has been provided by
This is what I like about Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh is a real American city. It's not some boutique city. It's not a city where people sip a lot of lattes. It's a city where people work. It's a city where people make money. It's a city where people drink. That's why I like Pittsburgh. That's not the politically correct Pittsburgh. That's not the Chamber of Commerce Pittsburgh, but that's my Pittsburgh. And that's the Pittsburgh I usually cover.
Carl Prine is an investigative reporter with the Pittsburgh Tribune-Review. He's worried about the city he covers, even on a festive occasion.
This is opening day for the Pittsburgh Pirates. They're playing the World Series champions, the St. Louis Cardinals. He's giving him fastballs and he's not swinging. The ghosts of pirate glory are looking on. It is a full house, standing room only. Got tens of thousands of people here. We're about 2.5 blocks away from the railroad, the Norfolk Southern Line. And all day long, they've been bringing in millions of pounds of hazmat, including chlorine gas. And in the event of a spill, you would have a lot of people dead and a lot of people running, trying to get out, and they won't be able to get out. If you're a terrorist and you were looking at the perfect day to kill 10,000 people and the perfect way to do it, you would want to have a pre-positioned weapon of mass destruction. And we're delivering them 2.5 blocks away on our rail lines. The wind is blowing the right way right now.
In the wake of 9/11, Carl Prine read a disturbing detail about hijacker Mohammed Atta. In early 2001, Atta had surveyed a chemical plant in Tennessee. It contained enough sulfur dioxide to kill 60,000 nearby residents. Prine realized this wasn't just about New York and Washington. It wasn't just about airplanes. It was about killing as many Americans as possible anywhere in the country, fashioning weapons of mass destruction with raw materials from our own infrastructure.
I don't think any of us ever really forgets that just a few years ago, 5.5, nearly 3,000 people died in a matter of minutes. I can remember standing in this office with the other editors and several reporters and watching the buildings coming down and thinking, my God, I can't imagine that this is happening. God forbid that should ever happen, ever again. I think all of us who work in this newsroom take our job seriously about looking at those issues, and this story is part of that.
The story is about vulnerability. Pittsburgh is the famed steel city, home to about 500,000 people and surrounded by industry. Carl Prine has become an expert in the potential dangers posed by the storage and transport of industrial chemicals.
It wouldn't be just how many people were killed, it'd be the way they died. I mean, when you're talking about chlorine gas or anhydrous ammonia, well, let me explain anhydrous ammonia for you. Anhydrous ammonia is a chemical that will, because of its molecular makeup, it will look for wet spots on the human body. It will search out your lungs. It'll search out your eyeballs. This were a shipment of anhydrous ammonia. What do you want to hear? 1,000 blind people? Could you imagine 1,000 blind people in this stadium? Or if it's chlorine gas, a gas so corrosive it'll eat through human teeth. But you're talking about literally people bleached white.
Prine is a former U.S. Marine with expertise in chemical and biological warfare. When he began his reporting, he knew that in the event of an accident or sabotage by terrorists, a gaseous cloud of chlorine or other toxins could disperse easily throughout a major city. So Prine pitched his editors on a story that would eventually become an unprecedented journalistic mission. He would test the security of chemical sites across the country by seeing if he could breach that security himself.
I certainly don't know the mind of a terrorist, but I viewed it as kind of the same thing a terrorist would do. They were going to go blow something up. They would certainly go, in the words of the old movies, case the joint, and that's kind of what he was doing.
Yeah. When I case a joint, I like to see what's the most vulnerable thing. Sometimes I'll look to see when guards are asleep. There have been times I've walked past sleeping guards. If you can just drive in, I'll just drive in. If you can go in through a rail yard, I'll go in through a rail yard. I'd walk up, I'd take a picture of the tank, standing on it, waving from it. then I'd leave. Most of the time, they didn't even know I was there. I'd say 99% of the time, they didn't know I was there.
Prine couldn't predict the effect his reporting would have. And he says it wasn't his job to care what the political impact might be. He simply believed he was doing his duty.
He's pretty much fearless. And I don't mean that in a comic book way. I mean that seriously. He's not afraid to get arrested. He's not afraid to get pushed around on some site that he's gone to. And that's great because that makes a good reporter.
Prine would begin what he calls his mission in December 2001. For guidance on slipping into chemical plants undetected, he turned to an experienced source, Greenpeace, an environmental group known for occasionally breaching security in order to prove a point.
Greenpeace activists break into chemical plants and rail yards all the time. It's part of what they do. It's part of their protest. And when I'm talking to these guys, I'm talking shop. It's a band of thieves for these guys. And no matter what I think about their message, which I have no opinion on one way or the other, I admire their handiwork.
Greenpeace is very knowledgeable of how to get into chemical plants or any kind of facility. And so diversion, security, those are all things that we're used to getting around. And what our experience showed us is that chemical plants are among the most porous to penetration of any facilities in the United States. Carl's been an extremely principled journalist in not trying to take sides or advocate anything. And of course, in his case, he went in completely under daylight, walking right into the gates. We often call that hiding in plain sight.
Because I'm camera illiterate, I tend to use disposable cameras. I just walked through the chain link fence there. It's actually like 2 feet across, they spent probably thousands and thousands of dollars putting barbed wire on the top of the fence. You could just walk in the back. Actually, we got even hundreds of more of these.
Here we go. This is near San Francisco. Atlanta. Washington. Las Vegas. Atlanta. That's chlorine gas.
New Jersey.
Tacoma. Organophosphate.
Texas.
That's in Georgia.
Tacoma.
More toxic chemicals.
Here I am listening to a boom box in Atlanta. I was actually inside their propane control room where they direct the movement of propane. I guess they had all gone to lunch and they left the radio on, so I...
Carl is in his own little world when he's doing his reporting. You know, he puts his head down and he starts writing or he starts working on something and he looks up and boy, it's a different day. I really kind of have to be his human clock and kind of remind him, hey, honey, it's time. You haven't eaten all day. And he won't stop. He won't stop for lunch. He won't stop for dinner. If he's working on something, he'll go the whole night.
Logging thousands of miles to cities including Houston, Baltimore, and Chicago, the reporter had amassed a mountain of evidence of lax security. In April 2002, the Trib published Carl Prine's reporting on almost unfettered access to chemical tanks and control rooms at some of the nation's most potentially lethal sites.
Every site that Carl went to, we told the company involved that we got in, that we were there, that we walked in essentially, well, not essentially, unquestioned. We just walked in. I mean, there wasn't any magic to it. We walked in. There's no magic to this. No magic. One of the places that he went to, somebody from the company called up and said, oh, you couldn't possibly have been here. You couldn't possibly have been here. And Carl sent him a picture that was taken in their restroom.
In Washington, there was shock that a reporter gained such easy access to tank after tank of stored chemicals, chemicals that had the potential to kill or injure tens or even hundreds of thousands. New Jersey Senator John Corzine called for legislation mandating stringent security at 15,000 sites around the country. Meanwhile, the Department of Homeland Security said it would make safeguarding plants a top priority. And industry leaders responded with their own pledges to tighten security. At this plant, Carl Prine was told, the company had simply given up storing one dangerous chemical.
They said, hey, we just want you to know that you did your story, and we no longer have anhydrous ammonia. And one of the ways you can tell is because they don't have a windsock up. Usually they have an orange sock that will mark where every chemical is. They'll tell you which way the wind's blowing. They don't have an orange sock. They have an American flag, but no orange sock.
Few companies took such extraordinary steps, and most balked at being regulated. Represented by the powerful lobby group, the American Chemistry Council, the $635 billion a year industry agreed on the need for better security, but vowed to get the job done voluntarily. Prine would believe that when he saw it. In early 2003, Carl Prine spent 4 months as an embedded reporter in Kuwait and Iraq. When he came home, he was back on the chemical security beat. This time, he hit the road co-investigating with a television team from 60 Minutes, visiting sites including the Neville Chemical Company outside Pittsburgh.
We walked in right through the rail line, about 200 meters, jogged right. We walked by employees, we waved to them. Within 100 meters after that, we were at the boron trifluoride. We went to go find the guy who was in charge of security.
Steve Croft for 60 Minutes.
With a camera crew in tow, Prine finally attracted some attention. He and correspondent Steve Croft were cited for trespassing.
60 Minutes decided to plead out the case and pay the fine. And we said almost immediately, no, we're not going to do that. We're going to plead not guilty because we are not guilty.
Judge, he said, did you see the 60-minute episode about Neville Island? And as soon as he told me that, I knew all about the case. It was instantaneously. The way I looked at it, there was no harm done, cost benefit. What was the harm? I said, the Tribune and Mr. Prine, did he render the public service, making us aware of this dangerous situation? And I'm not going to find him guilty, and I'm dismissing the case.
And, you know, as it turned out, we saved $25 and 60 Minutes didn't. They paid the fine.
In November of 2003, after visiting more than 50 plants across the country, Prine shared with Trib readers the results of his joint investigation with 60 Minutes. His lead said it all. 2 years after 9/11, terrorists still have unfettered access to potentially catastrophic amounts of toxins and explosives nationwide. Many readers thought Prine's reporting was a public service, but others were angry and questioned his patriotism. One reader emailed him, I think it is really moronic that you go around to chemical plants and point out their weaknesses. All you are doing is giving any possible terrorist something to feed off of.
We knew there would be critics. We knew that going in. We knew that people would say, oh, you're teaching terrorists how to make bombs, or how to blow things up. We understood that. It's not about teaching terrorists how to make bombs, and I don't think it did. They know how to make bombs. What it's about is raising the public awareness of the security of this country, the internal security of this country, not the security overseas, the security at home.
Meanwhile, in Washington, John Corzine's chemical security legislation also had its detractors. Under intense pressure from the chemical lobby and without White House backing, the bill languished. But even in the absence of legislation, Carl Prine began to see action taken by chemical companies. Spending on security increased, gates and cameras were installed, and corporations which had once wanted Prine arrested were now asking his advice, even inviting him to address industry conferences, which he does to this day.
These aren't just guys in suits. These are guys in charge of security. A lot of them are former military. A lot of them are former Secret Service, FBI, a lot of state police officers. See a lot of short haircuts. This was my point with Clorox in Houston. Okay, yeah, I got inside because a contractor again left the gate open. Clorox. Yeah. So on your website at the time, you actually had a layout of a chemical plant or of your Clorox facility. I remember when I was engaging with Clorox, I said, well, how did you know where to go? And I said, well, I need to turn right because on your internet, you had a thing. This is what a leach plant looks like. I'm Carl Prine. I'm with the Pittsburgh Trib. When I look at a plant, I look at it like a terrorist. I look at when your guards are there. I look at where they sit. I look at when they sleep. If I'm looking at a property for, say, 3 days, I know who leaves the gates open. I know where your smokers are, who leave your doors open. I know where most of the chemicals are because there's a big orange sock right above it. My job is to figure out how to get there and how to get back without getting caught. The only person who actually ever came up to me and said, what are you doing here, was the New Kensington Wastewater Treatment Facility. And the only reason why they came out to see what they were doing is that, well, with your glasses, you kind of like look at a guy from EPA. We thought we'd get you off the property. They assume if you're on the rail line, you're supposed to be there.
In one of America's few remaining two newspaper towns, the Tribune-Review competes fiercely with the paper across the river, the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette. Sometimes on national stories, sometimes on those of local interest.
Going down to the pirate game, the principal, a female principal,
contacted
the school district to let them know that there was an accident. They're now starting to transport patients.
Newsroom, this is Pete.
The first one came over with a neck injury.
Yes. Yeah. You're kidding. Okay. How do you know that? Okay. But it's the choir. They were going to sing the national anthem.
But they told me it was eighth graders. So that.
That's my 5-year-old can sing.
Yeah.
In 2004, Carl Prine found himself on all kinds of stories, from auto accidents to unsolved local murders. He'd left the terror beat behind for a while, but something had been weighing on his mind. And in July of 2005, Carl Prine had an announcement to make.
I guess I wasn't really surprised when he came home one day and kind of said, listen, I'd like to talk to you about something. I wasn't thrilled by any means.
He came into this office. I was here. He came in and said, I signed up for the National Guard. I said, you what? And he said, I signed up. I'm going to go back for a year. I said, you're kidding me, Carl. And he said, no, I'm not. And I said, the National Guard. And he said, yeah. The Marines wouldn't take me because I was too old. He had been a Marine earlier, before he ever came here. He did a hitch in the Marines. And I was dumbfounded. I was dumbfounded that day.
I mean, Carl has really strong feelings about, you know, things that are right and things that are wrong. And I know that he felt, I guess, guilty that he wasn't contributing somehow in any way, and he felt like he needed to do that. It was his duty to do so because there was a real shortage of personnel over there, and he felt like he could really make a difference.
And off he went for 1 year. And, you know, I thought about him all the time. Every time you'd see somebody shot, you know, and, you know, you wonder. It's in the back of your mind. Is that Carl? Is that my guy?
Prine signed up with the Pennsylvania National Guard. He was sent to Iraq and assigned first to one and then another unit in treacherous Anbar province. Combined, they would take extraordinary casualties, losing 25 men during Prine's tour of duty. This footage was shot by a member of his battalion.
I was with a platoon for a while where I was a 50 caliber gunner. We were supporting the Iraqi army. We were making runs, taking detainees to Ramadi.
Stop! ID. Check for secondaries, check for
But the main job that I did was the missions with the Iraqi army.
Ask him if he's ever been recruited.
When I was tagging along with the Iraqi army, one of our jobs was to find out who was working in Al-Qaeda. We would go around the villages in the area, and we would develop sources, much like a reporter would.
Has anyone tried to get him to join the insurgency?
The job was to find the people who were the hardcore al-Qaeda. And if someone was hiding them or someone was supporting them, your job was to uncover that network too. Different guys in my battalion would have different experiences. I think mine was unremittingly bad. I lost some friends.
Remarkably, Prine survived four separate attacks involving improvised explosive devices, IEDs. He was left with debilitating migraines caused by post-concussive trauma, controlled only by strong medicine. In July of 2006, the man who had been accused by some of aiding America's enemies returned home with fellow members of the Pennsylvania National Guard. They had survived a harrowing year.
You know, he saw people get hurt. He saw people get killed. It was a tough time for him.
A number of us said to him when he first came back, take some time off. Stay at home. Go enjoy life. Take a trip. And we didn't mean take a trip with a reporter's notebook and a pen. And within a matter of days after getting out of the uniform, he's back running around the countryside.
When I was driving around, I was still looking for IEDs. But I guess because one of my jobs as a gunner was to look for that stuff.
An improvised explosive device tends to be cone-shaped. It concentrates the force of the blast into one point in order to penetrate armor. Once I began to see how easy it was to open up armored vehicles with an IED, I began to realize that if you can melt a tank on the MSR, you can open up a rail car pretty easily.
Rail cars. Now Prine wondered, why would a terrorist on American soil bother scaling the fence of a storage site when rail car after rail car filled with potentially lethal chemicals sat unguarded outside the gates? And so it was that in the summer of 2006, Carl Prine still wasn't satisfied. True, his tour of duty in Iraq had fulfilled his wish to serve alongside others who fought there. And his investigation into chemical security had stimulated industry to upgrade safety. By now, New Jersey Senator John Corzine, still pushing for a chemical safety law, had even cited Prine's work in the Senate record. Yet the thought of unprotected American rail cars carrying dangerous chemicals was nagging at Carl Prine. It was time for a new mission, testing the security of the nation's rail transport. He figured it would be easy enough to convince his editors.
This is the home of the Pittsburgh Tribune-Review. It is housed in the D.L. Clark building. That's where, for generations, they made the Clark candy bar, which is nutritious and delicious. And the actual rail road literally ran into the building. You can see the railroad bridge. Not only does that railroad still lead into our newsroom, but actually it leads into the office of my former editor who had me doing the chemical plant stories to begin with. It's not hard to sell an editor on a story when it's happening outside his window.
This one's like a buffet if you're a terrorist. You got your flammables, you got your explosives, you got your highly toxic chemicals, you got your acids. It's about everything you want. Hydrochloric acid. Explosive. In fact, that was anthracite coal, probably. Wow, anhydrous hydrogen fluoride. Not good. Some explosive stuff, some flammable stuff. Explosives, flammables.
Deadly serious. Knowing what terrorists could do, and with firsthand knowledge of how they might do it, Carl Prine set off once again to hide in plain sight, thinking like a terrorist.
Funding for Exposé has been provided by